the stage, they just scared I'ma kill. We bring the king to the world, dog, I don't even stress. Act town made me, don't back down and they hate me. Rock up on the
place. I have one of my dear friends, one of my brothers in the Lord, Mr. Carl Fontaine.
Hey, it's Fontaine. Nah, wait. Like I'm in the studio? Nah. What up, guys? I'm Carl Fontaine, sitting here with my friend Drew.
Yeah, you guys, so we are here tonight. It is Southern California. It is 7:02 p.m., and tonight we have episode 5 in store for you guys. None of this stuff is rehearsed. None of it. We just kind of pick a topic.
Yeah. I purposely didn't watch one before this so I could kind of go into it fresh. I didn't want to, like, expect anything.
That's how this works. Yeah. We just trust in Jesus, and we love Jesus, and we're just here to talk about Jesus and what he's done in our lives.
Definitely.
So tonight, you guys, before we get started, if you guys want to connect with us on social media at ChristFM, on Instagram, it's ChristFM TV. Obviously, here on Facebook, you can connect with us. And our YouTube channel, the link will also be in the description at ChristFM TV on YouTube. All these episodes are edited and reposted on that channel, so you can share it with your friends, share it with your family members, share it with your cat, share it with your dog, whoever you want to, you know, share that with. But also, Carl, what are your plugs?
So on Twitter and Instagram is Carl_Fontaine. And then Facebook is Who is Carl Fontaine? And then CarlFontaine.com. So all that, you can hit me up on it. I'm there. Follow me. I'll follow back. All of that. So, yeah.
Sick, sick, sick. Well, let's get into this episode of The Connect.
Cool. Let's get it.
So first off, we are going to talk about Carl's upcoming new EP. Carl is a hip-hop artist. He is also an individual that does ministry in different places, not only just in churches, but in secular venues and reaching the world and reaching people who don't know Jesus with the gospel, with his music. And so tonight we're going to talk a little bit about Carl's EP.
Cool, cool.
And we are also going to hit on the topic and subjects of fear, anxiety, and depression in light of the Bible. And I know this is a big one. We're not claiming that we can hit all of it.
Everything, yeah.
Everything. We're just going to hit on some personal things that God has gotten us through in light of the Bible. And in hope that you guys are encouraged in your own lives, in your own walks in life. And maybe if you don't know Jesus, maybe today could be the day that you get to know him, because he has helped us absolutely 100% with these issues. So let's get this started. So, Carl.
Let's get it, man.
Your new EP.
So, yeah.
What's it looking like? What's going on? What's it called?
It's in the works right now. I'm trying to get everything recorded. I got the cover done for it. I got what I want it to look like, kind of the theme of what we're doing, but trying to go with something more new. I want it to be like refreshing, sound-wise, quality-wise, topic-wise. I want to hit on a lot of different things that I didn't hit on and Never Back Down. Mm-hmm. And yeah, I don't want to give a title yet, but definitely will pretty soon, like in the next couple weeks. I want to at least get the songs done. It's going to be 3 songs, probably no features. So, yeah, man, it's I wish I would have had more done tonight so I could have showed you a little bit of it, but it's not much done yet.
Well, because your last album was Never Back Down.
Yeah.
And that was, listening to that, bro, like the intro alone would have been enough for me.
Crazy.
Because just everything that you came out saying, you know, some of the lines that you were hitting, you were speaking like straight up. It sounded like, and I've told you this before, I was like, it sounded like you were like just finally deciding to stand up to your fears and your failures and just like burst out.
That's
and
true.
Just say what you had to say.
I had to, man, because I really just made that album for me. Yeah. It was really like therapeutic to kind of walk through that, because when you deal with things like depression and when you deal with fear a lot, you don't really hear a lot of like positive reinforcement to kind of pull you out of that. You don't really know where to go sometimes. So I wanted to give myself that. So I listened to it myself. It's kind of like, hey, like, okay, we can get through this. We can get through this day by day, man. So little by little. And that's what I was hoping to give people with Never Back Down. Just day by day, let's push through it. The strength that came through me from Jesus was crazy because I felt like it was more vulnerable. I felt like it was real. Mm-hmm. People go through a lot of things that I talked about on the album. So
yeah, I could definitely listening to that, man. It's better than just like, you know, and I don't want to offend anybody out here. I make the same kind of music, like turn up music.
No.
It was more than that. No. It was like your heart just, the only way I can explain it is just like bursting out, bro. Yeah. Like I'm done being afraid. I don't know if I'm misquoting you, but this is what I got from it. Like listening to it, like I'm done being afraid. I'm done like sitting down. I'm not going to shut up anymore. Cause you have a line in your intro and it's like, you talk about like your family says I'm a failure and this, and I'm like, man, bro, like go, bro, you know, like let's go, you know,
it's real, man. Especially doing music, bro. You understand that because there's always a side of us that's really competitive when we do music, even doing Christian music. And it's like you're competing with yourself and you notice what other people are doing. It's different than like worldly competitiveness. It's like I'm competing with myself to be better. Mm-hmm. And then on this end, I notice what everybody else is doing. And it's like, do I measure up? And it's like I question myself, like, do I measure up with everyone else? And like God spoke to me and was like, don't worry about everybody else. Like you really gotta work on you. And I really had to work on me a lot. But when your family is like, I have people in my family that's like, hey bro, you're getting kinda old now, you're 26, man, when are you gonna give it up? At what point are you gonna stop rapping? Because you've been rapping for like 13 years, man. I hear that often. And it's like, what is making it?
Yeah.
What do you consider? What do you consider making it? And what's important? What do these people look for? And what's important to them to consider somebody have made it? So they often say, like, certain people in my family, man, they often question and doubt what I'm doing. Mm. I've got to just shake that off, man.
Yeah. Yeah, man. Like, you know, I really appreciated that album and that transparency. I know hearing you talk about it in the past, like you said that you wanted this album to not only just address and introduce people to Jesus, but to teach them how to walk
through
with
it.
Him through it, through the struggles. Yeah. You want to kind of hit on that? Like, what do you mean by that?
This Never Back Down was how I told you before, kind of in a past conversation. There's music that kind of helps you transition from the world to Christianity, and then there's music for like Christians to listen to when they're there and they understand it and they know the things of the word. But I really struggle finding people that's like, hey, I'm going through stuff, like stuff happens and I'm struggling with this. How do you deal with this? How do I deal with this? What do you say in this moment? What things do you go through that are relatable to what other things? Because not everybody's in the same place, bro. So people need music for all stages of life, man. And that was huge for me. I wanted to make music for people to walk through what they're going through with Jesus. So that's what Never Back Down was.
Yeah, man. So what would you say, like, out of your entire album on Never Back Down, what was maybe the one song that kind of captured like what you were really trying to capture throughout that whole album? Because I know sometimes like making music, you're like making, sometimes you make like 20, 30 songs just to hit one thing you were really trying to say. Like, was there maybe one song that you know hit home closest to what you were really trying to say from the heart?
I think the intro summed it up, bro. The intro was so heavy. I recorded that last.
Oh, wow.
Actually, no. Third to last, because I made a couple songs before it. But yeah, the intro was huge, and it kind of helped me sum up and kind of give a summary of what the album was about in its entirety. Mm-hmm. So that's why it started like that. I had to give that much energy. I was sick when I recorded it, like you can kind of hear the difference in my voice. But we pushed through it, and yeah, man, the intro, that was the one.
Wow.
Yeah.
So since you dropped that album, like what not like sales wise or anything like that, but what has, have you seen any like response like from people, like not only just myself, like I'm telling you, but like anybody else, like, you know, has someone heard it or, you know, that it impacted them? Maybe you performed live, because I know you've performed live those songs countless times.
Yeah.
Is there anything that sticks out in particular that's happened since you dropped Never Back Down?
I think the trippiest thing that I'm not really used to is people like messaging me on social media, like, hey bro, I found your album somewhere on some website or something, and it really spoke to me.
Wow.
and it helped me get through what I was going through, so that was huge. And then what else? Going to shows and talking to like kids and teenagers and stuff, and them just telling me things that they're going through that's kind of similar, and asking me what I do, how I deal with it, and if I can pray with them. And it's little moments like that that make it like, okay, God, I see what you were doing. I see what you were doing with this.
You know, like when you say, you know, like some people say, you know, like I'm like 26 now, and I'm getting older, and people are asking me like, are you gonna do this forever?
Yeah.
You know, have you made it yet? Have you accomplished what you wanted to accomplish? Like stuff like that. Like when you got a kid that, you know, there's maybe no one in the entire world that they would ever listen to about Jesus or encouragement or the Bible.
Yeah.
Like when you got a kid that comes up to you and is like, I'm encouraged, bro. Like God, I really feel like God spoke to me. Like, would you say that that's enough for you?
That is huge. That's huge. You want to impact as many people as possible. So that's really like the main part of it, bro. So I'm cool with performing at like clubs and schools and stuff like that, because they don't get exposed to it in any kind of way. And I've had people tell me that my music isn't Christian enough or whatever, but they don't even get exposed to a quarter of what, you know, what I give to them. So it's good to hear. It's always good to have that feedback, man.
Yeah, man, that's awesome, bro. Because, you know, like, it's tough, you know, like being an artist in the Christian, quote-unquote Christian world or universe, because on one side of the spectrum, you know, people are accusing you, like, is that biblical?
Yep.
Is it not biblical? But then on the other side, you also want to be transparent without compromising.
Yeah.
So you can actually relate to people. So you don't look like just some, you know, holier-than-thou religious zealot. And dude, even, like, your first, like, that's what I was getting from your first project.
Yeah, yeah.
The first project that I heard, what was it called again?
The Withdrawals.
The Withdrawals.
Yeah.
That alone was... What was that song that you had on there? I Ain't Holy.
Yeah.
Like that song, bro. Like I was just like, man, dude, like this dude gets it.
Yeah.
He's shooting for that balance, bro. So where you can honestly relate to people without compromising.
Yeah.
But at the same time, you're shooting that goal, and the goal is to reach that person with Jesus, you know?
In any way possible, man. Like you don't ever want to compromise the main message of what you're doing, but you also don't want to come off as like you said, holier than thou, because church hurt is huge.
It's huge.
And a lot of people are turned off by the church's, like, they feel like, I talk to a lot of people like that don't go to church anymore because they feel like there's a person up here that looks down on them. And then in a lot of churches, there's like levels of people that you have to go through to get to the pastor who looks down on these people who all look down to you.
Yeah.
So they feel like they don't measure up and like they're not good enough. And I'm like, bro, like none of us are, bro. So
yeah, none of us.
Let me fix this chair.
None of us.
So I like to give people that message, the message of hope in any situation, any place that you are in your life. You got hope, man. Definitely.
Yeah. And you know what was dope, bro? Like, before, or guys, before we started this episode, Carl and I were talking about Acts chapter 8.
Yeah.
And we were talking about how God, through the Holy Spirit and through Philip, he literally just reached this Ethiopian eunuch on his level, where he was at in his life.
Yeah.
And I think a lot of Christians fail to even attempt. God told Philip to just randomly go into the wilderness, right?
Yeah.
Like, just go into the wilderness. And the Bible doesn't say that Philip questioned God or prayed about it, bro.
Yeah,
like,
exactly.
The dude straight went out there.
Yeah.
But God had something for Philip, and it was to reach this Ethiopian eunuch.
Yeah.
Because the man was already seeking
truth. He came to worship, didn't he?
Yeah.
But he was coming up there to worship.
Yeah.
And he was able to get the gospel. Like I was telling you, he got the gospel right from the tap, bro. Right from one of the disciples, man.
Straight up.
And yeah, what stood out to me about that verse, like I was telling you, a lot of people have identity problems.
Mm-hmm.
And especially like in the black community, mm-hmm. they have identity problems finding themselves in the Bible. Like race is huge. Mm-hmm. Everybody wants to claim what color Jesus was and all of that stuff. It's cool. But in the Bible specifically, in Acts chapter 8, it says that there was an Ethiopian eunuch
mm-hmm.
who worked for the queen, who came to worship, and was given the gospel directly from one of the disciples,
mm-hmm.
from Philip. He was baptized, and when he came up out the water, Philip was gone.
He was gone.
He was gone.
He was taken away from the Spirit.
Yeah.
See, but the big part about that, a lot of people argue that Christianity is a white man's religion or a black man's religion, or it's just a Judaic religion.
Yeah.
There's so many arguments on that. But honestly, when you take a look at the Bible, you see how that was a work of God.
Yeah.
That wasn't a work of man.
Yeah. Yeah.
Philip could have been any race. He could have, whatever. It doesn't matter. That was a work of God reaching an individual where he was at.
That's
in
true.
His life, on his level, and he saved him.
Yeah. He did.
He saved him on the spot. Dude jumps out as whatever it was.
He was into some kind
whatever.
Of chariot.
Dude straight jumps out and gets
out the
baptized, bro. Like, on the spot, bro.
Yep.
I can only imagine, bro, if we were at, like, a high school and kids get saved, we start dunking pool and we'd probably get in trouble, dude.
You know, bring a little kiddie pool. But it's great. It's crazy, bro. That verse stood out to me so much. I've read it, like, a million times already. Because of how much it stood out to me and what I can pull from it to kind of just share with people, especially in my own community, man. Like, I'm like, obviously I'm black and
mm-hmm.
people I talk to are, so it's like, oh, why do you follow this white man's religion and blah blah blah. It's like, well, actually, bro, let me point a couple things out to you. Like, this white man's religion was taken back to Ethiopia. It doesn't go into detail of what happened next.
Mm-hmm.
It'd be cool to kind of like study that.
Yeah.
But like, it was taken back to the queen
mm-hmm.
of Ethiopia. I only can imagine like where it went from there, and the amount of truth this guy had with him, and he was given the gospel
mm-hmm.
and baptized, and what he did with that moving forward. That's huge.
And he wasn't a nobody.
Yeah,
he was a high-ranking government official that had contact with the queen.
Yeah,
he was an individual that. Like I told you earlier, it would be like rolling up on the Secretary of State with their barrage and all their people and their brigade and their crew and just
walking up to them
and like, look, Jesus, you know, and they get saved and they get dunked and baptized on the
right
spot.
On the spot.
But just to go to say that the Lord reaches everyone on all fronts.
Yeah.
The rich, the wealthy, the poor, the desolate, the nobodies, the somebodies.
Yeah.
If you take a look at the Bible, Jesus interacted, whether in physical form or through the Spirit, he interacted with and continues to interact with everyone. I mean, you take a look at Billy Graham, dude, he's probably the closest thing to a modern day prophet that we have.
Yeah.
He's called the president's pastor, the pastor of presidents. Like, this guy was in contact with United States presidents, giving them advice, shepherding them, walking them through their lives.
That's true.
But at the same time, Billy Graham did ministry in different parts of third world countries.
Yeah.
There were things that he did that the world didn't see.
Exactly.
That glorified
and
God
they didn't
as
have
well.
To see it.
Exactly.
They didn't have to see it, man.
You know, and people have to understand that I know there's so much, you know, racial bias about Christianity and even other religions, but at the end of the day, Jesus is not a racist.
Yeah.
And Jesus doesn't, the Bible's very clear. God shows no partiality to no man. It doesn't matter who you are, what color you are, or what background that you come from. Yes, there have been racist Christians that have blown it for all of us, black and white, brown and green, whatever.
Yeah.
But Jesus Christ himself, and this is why I want to emphasize this, is that Jesus Christ himself is not a racist bigot.
Yeah.
He doesn't hate gay people. He doesn't hate Mexicans. He doesn't hate blacks. He doesn't hate whites.
But Jesus died for all. People are flawed. And that's what, like, that's what people don't point out. That's what people don't point out, bro. People are flawed, and they make mistakes, and they say things that they shouldn't say.
Yeah.
And even though it reflects back on us in some kind of way, all it takes is, like, actually going through the Word and finding out what was actually done and how it was acted. Like, the Book of Acts. The Book of Acts wasn't the Crusades, bro, that happened. Mm-hmm. Like, that's not how they spread religion. And it wasn't the colonists that came from Europe over here to the Native Americans and stuff. That's not how they did it.
Mm-hmm.
It's not how it was brought about, bro. So.
Yeah. And, you know, on that note, I want to encourage people, you know, if you're watching this and you've been burnt by the church, or, you know, you're studying, like, the dark ages of Christianity, which I wouldn't even call Christianity, like the Crusades and just blasphemous things that have been done in the name of Jesus. Just take a look at the Bible. Take a look at who Jesus is. Get your eyes on what he's done and how much he loves you and what he says and him alone. Because when you get your eyes on people and you get your eyes on Christians, you're going to be let down every single time because none of us are him.
Yeah.
None of us are him. So, bro, just on a final note, if you can, for your new EP, if you can give us, do you have like a theme? Like, do you have a next theme coming out for the next one?
This one is going to be about growth.
Mm-hmm.
About blooming. I've been really influenced by like little stuff, like the nature and how flowers bloom and they don't look to the next flower, to the left or to the right of them. They just bloom, they just grow. And that's what this is about. It's about growth and just growing and becoming. So it's kind of the theme I want to attack with this. And, it's a weird theme. That's why it's taken me kind of long to conceptualize it. But that's what I want to go with.
Nice.
Yeah.
Sick.
Yeah, man.
Is the homie Dave D?
He got his hand on production.
Shout out to Dave D.
Definitely, man.
Put that plug in there if you need someone to master your album. That dude will hook you up. Sick.
Definitely.
So let's transition. Let's use this as an opportunity to transition to our topics tonight.
Cool.
So we're going to talk about fear, we're going to talk about anxiety, and we're going to talk about depression in light of the Bible and our own personal experiences tonight. And so I wanted to ask you, just from the get-go, let's talk about fear, because I know this is something that you rap about, this is what you talk about, you preach. Like when I've heard you preach the word, there's always this like boldness. So how has this been something that you or God has help you to deal with in light of who he is, this fears and insecurities?
I think that when the Bible talks about, like, I'm just going to paraphrase. When the Bible talks about not having fear and having the love of Christ instead.
Mm-hmm.
So when I look at fear, I see fear as being at the complete opposite of God. It can fill your heart as much as God can, and not allow him to get in. And it's something that I struggle with often. Like, fear and depression is something that I struggle with often.
Yeah.
And the only way I can get through it is to try to keep my eyes focused. Sometimes you vary and you look off and you let things affect you. But like my favorite scripture is Psalms 27:1. And I put it on all my shirts and everything. It says, "The Lord is my light and my salvation. Whom shall I fear?"
Yeah.
And I constantly have to remind myself that the Lord is my light. Whom shall I fear? That, to me, is boldness. When that was written and I read that with the boldness I could hear the boldness that it was written with in my head. Like, whom shall I fear? Why should I be afraid of this situation? God hasn't given us the spirit of fear. So why should I be afraid? That's the constant theme that kept coming up and never back down. And it's like, why am I scared to write this? Why am I scared to say this? Why am I afraid to go here? Why am I afraid to record this song? Why am I afraid to talk to this person? And like, fear will keep us from sharing the gospel with people. Fear will keep us from accepting the gospel. Fear will keep us from going to church because of what people might say and how people might react. And fear is dangerous, bro. It's dangerous. I think that's one of the most dangerous things as a believer to deal with, is fear.
Well, think about this. Fear and unbelief, they go hand in hand.
True.
And that was the main reason why the children of Israel failed to go into the promised land. And that was huge. It wasn't that they didn't want to go in. It wasn't that they didn't believe that God could get them in. When you read that in detail, when you see that God specifically commanded the 12 spies to go in, go check it out. They come back and only two gave the report. They all had the same report. There's giants in the land. It's insane. It was fear. This fear just flooded the entire people. And they all start talking amongst themselves. We can't do this. We can't go in there. There's giants. We're going to get slaughtered. We're like, they literally say, we're like little insects compared to them.
Crazy.
And when you really think about it, the Bible's very clear. It literally details that God was not pleased. Now, I don't say that to say that if you're afraid, God's not pleased with you, but I do want to warn you that fear, it has the potential of robbing everything that God wants to do in your life, because when you read the Bible, God judged them, and they did not go into the promised land because of their fear.
And they were lost in the wilderness.
But what I want to flip on that is all they had to do was trust that God was who he said he was, and that God was going to do what he said he was going to do and bless them with what he said he was going to bless them with. And you could take that with anything in your life.
Anything.
Like, you know, whatever you're walking into, if it's a marriage or if it's a new job or a new ministry opportunity, there's always that flooding fear in your heart, and you're just like, but there's so much here. There's so much potential of failure. Or what are people going to think about me? Or if I sound dumb or if I look dumb? And it's the same concept. You can't allow what you think people might think about you, failure to fill your heart with fear and to stop you from what God wants to do in your life.
It's true, man. It's crazy, because when you're in fear, all you can see is the negative side. All you can see is the what ifs. And fear will literally paralyze you. You won't be able to move. And, you know what I mean? Movement and growth is a constant theme in the Bible, man. They weren't stagnant. But fear will keep you stagnant. Fear will keep you from your blessings. It's a scary thing. Kind of ironic, scary.
No, it really is.
But it is.
It is something that keeps you in like a cage. Because it's like it's like this. It's like you're like in a cage, but the door's wide open.
That's true.
And the lights are on. Because you are like in your own mind. Because there's things that you're afraid of that you don't even know are actually there. But at the end of the day, the reason why I say the door's open. Is because God is calling you.
That's true.
And calling you and calling you and calling you. And this is something that I had to learn as a Christian, because my past, all I've ever known is failure. All I've ever known is doubts and things not working out and just afraid to even try and go and get a job.
That's true.
But I wanted to share this, and you've already quoted it, but I'm going to quote it again. The Bible says in 2 Timothy chapter 1, beginning in verse 7, "For God has not given us a spirit of fear, but of power and of love and of a sound mind," or self-control. That doesn't mean we're perfect, bro. It doesn't mean that, you're going to be like turning up like King David against Goliath every single day of your life, but you can.
Yeah, yeah.
It means that there is some truth to who we are as born again Christians that we can fall back on and always remind ourselves. It doesn't mean that we just walk around like arrogant, like we can take anything on, because not, then that would defeat the purpose that
exactly.
when we are weak, he is strong.
He's strong, exactly.
It means that we have someone to come to and to abide in and to give us strength and to walk in that.
Exactly. Continuously, man. It's, what can I say? Like, we deal with fear a lot too when we go into these situations, like when we go to schools.
Mm-hmm.
And it's not really a fear like, hey, I'm afraid of the kids. It's like concern of how they're going to take it, how they're going to react.
Yeah.
How they're going to respond to the gospel. Are we doing the right thing?
Mm.
Are we going to get anyone trying to, like, they shut you down?
Yeah.
Anyone trying to shut us
yeah.
down or anything, man? Because we're privileged in the United States to be able to freely share the gospel.
Yeah.
A lot of countries you can't do that in. So, you know what I mean? It is a lot of fear that'll hold us back sometimes.
Mm-hmm.
I've had it myself when... Even in shows, in churches, going and sharing with people.
Yeah.
I've been afraid to go speak to that person, not knowing how they would receive it, or if they think and look at me like I'm trying to be holier than thou,
yeah.
and talk down on them, like even family members, anything, man. So.
You know, it reminds me of when God called Ezekiel. When you read the book of Ezekiel in the first few chapters, you see that God, before he sends him out, he's literally speaking to him, and he's telling him, first of all, he tells him to, like, eat the scroll, like, know the word.
Yeah.
But you're going to go out to these people. They're stiff-necked. They are going to reject you.
Yeah.
They are going to hate you, but I'm sending you out on my behalf
yeah.
to speak to the people. You simply communicate this message
yeah.
to these people. God warns them, like, they're going to hate you.
Yeah.
They're going to reject you. They're not going to want anything to do with what you have to say,
yeah.
but I am calling you. And he literally says, do not be afraid of their faces
mm-hmm.
or their threats.
Yeah.
And that's encouraging, like, as you're talking about, like, the high schools
yeah,
and doing
sure.
ministry and standing before people, I constantly have to remind myself, like, I can't be afraid of the results because I have no control over them.
True.
I can't be afraid of what people are going to think because I have no control over them. I can't even be afraid of what people are going to do because I have
no control
over them. We have to leave all those three things
to God.
To God.
Definitely.
Man. You know what I mean?
Because if we don't, then we don't go.
Yeah.
We don't go. I was scared to go to Mexico for the first time.
Yeah.
I don't speak Spanish. I was in there asking everybody, I'm asking my friends, like, look, bro, like, all in America, all I hear about in Mexico is that they chop people up, and I'm like, look, bro.
Shout out to Juan.
I know, right? If I go and I don't make it back, tell my babies I love them, because I don't know what's going to happen, man. But fear would have kept me from going, bro, a lot of the time. Now it's like home. Like, I go, and it's like, I know where.
Always blessed.
Yeah, always, man. And I know my way around the city and all that. I could talk to Juan's mom in, like, broken Spanish now a little bit. So it's cool, man, but the fear will keep you from... Fear will keep you from a lot, bro.
Yeah, man. I love what Paul says in Romans 8. Like, if God be for us,
who
could be
against
us?
Yeah.
And you have to take that at face value.
Yeah.
You have to take that, like, literally.
Yeah.
Because God is always for you. He's not always for you when you're, like, sinning up against him.
Yeah.
But when you are understanding that you are a child,
yeah.
son or daughter, for you ladies, of God.
Yeah.
And he is constantly in your corner interceding on your behalf. He's gone before you.
Yeah.
He's with you.
Yeah.
He's for you. He's literally got a will and a plan for your life that all you have to do is just be like, I'm down.
Yeah.
Not to be afraid.
Not at all, bro.
You know, I was telling Pastor Chris when he was here last week, bro. Before I started Christ FM, dude, I was so scared.
Yeah.
Because I thought that I was going to fail. I didn't think any of this was going to work.
Yeah.
I didn't think that I was, like, worthy or good enough.
Yeah.
I remember, dude, I went to the college church, bro, and this one, Pastor Chris,
he's super live, come on, bro.
Come on, I love you, bro. And he's just like, he's preaching and he's praying and he's like, you know what? This is what he said. He's like, Nehemiah, he had to build up the courage to go and ask the king for permission to go do what God called him to do. He had to finally face that fear. And I was like, he's like, that's what you got to do too. I'm like,
I can picture it. You know what I'm like? Like pumped.
But bro, like that like, it just like cracked my fear in the jaw, dude. Because I was like, all right, dude, like I got to do this. And like, it's all history.
Yeah.
Like now we're all involved with this stuff. And now God is doing amazing things. And, but you know, I just want to encourage you, like, do the same thing. Like, if you know that God is calling you and he's giving you confirmation through scripture, through trustworthy elders and people that are wise, you know, just stop doubting and just take a step of faith. Because without faith, it's impossible to please God.
That's true.
It's impossible. And those who come to him must believe that he is, and he is a rewarder of those who diligently seek him.
Yeah.
And so let's hit a little bit on anxiety, bro.
Okay.
Because this is a huge subject that I know that millions of people, especially young people, are struggling with. And obviously, you know, we're sensitive to the fact that there are like physical, you know, people are diagnosed and
clinical anxiety, issues. Clinical depression.
But there are principles that the Word of God and even the Spirit of God can heal.
Yeah.
And you know, your own personal experience with anxiety, like how is this something that God has matured you through and helped you with?
You know what? My struggle honestly wasn't anxiety as much.
Yeah.
As much as it was depression.
Yeah.
So I couldn't speak on that.
Yeah, yeah.
I couldn't speak on that strong enough to help someone else get through it.
Mm-hmm.
But I do understand, like, anxiety goes hand in hand with the fear of the unknown, and it's definitely a thing that people struggle with. Yeah. But like I said, on my end, it's mainly the fear and the depression. So
you know, with anxieties, the Bible it the Bible is so wonderful because there are key things that humans struggle with, and it hits them all. Mm. There are some things that we will never have answers to, but anxiety. Excuse me, guys. The Bible, I'm not having an attack, but the Bible hits on it so clearly because there are so many people that the Bible hits on. Worry, worrying about the future, worrying about your future finances, worrying about your future clothing, worrying about your future sustenance, where you're going to live or what you're going to do in the future. Mm. And a lot of people that struggle with anxiety, some of them don't even understand why, but a lot of people have fear and they have worry about the future and things that they don't have control over, or things that that happened, and you're like replaying scenarios over and over and over and over in your mind. And a lot of people, they find themselves, because of the lack of control that they have over their lives, it gives them anxiety.
That's true.
And it causes them to be afraid because they really have no control.
Yeah.
And I could be wrong. That might not be the reason why you struggle with anxiety. But, you know, doing ministry for the past 5 years, this is a lot of the stuff that I've heard and that I run into. A lot of people will say, you know, I don't know what I'm going to do. I don't know how I'm going to do this. I don't know how I'm going to do that. Or, you know, there's just this anxiety. I'm so afraid of this and that. And I'm just thinking about everything going on in my life. Yeah. And the Bible says this. The Bible's very clear. In Philippians chapter 4 and verse 6, it says, "Be anxious for nothing, but in everything by prayer and supplication with thanksgiving. Mm-hmm. Let your requests be made known to God, and the peace of God, which surpasses all understanding, will guard your hearts and minds through Christ Jesus."
Yeah.
And you know, instantly you might be like, you don't understand. Well, yeah. I just know that the Bible addresses this, and it's very clear.
And it's very difficult to see it as face value, to just see it and accept it that's things that everybody struggles with, bro, but that's why you got to walk towards that. That's true. Like, and the Bible also talks about seeking the kingdom of God, seeking first the kingdom of God when you deal with worrying and, and things like that. Like, worrying is huge. Worrying is something I deal with. And even to this day, bro, worrying about how bills are going to get paid and worried about how food is going to get on the table. And it's never not been there. Never had to, never had to struggle for anything, bro. But I still worry about it.
Yeah.
And to, even if it, and you get blessed and it gets taken care of, the next time, you still worry about it.
Yeah.
And that messes up relationships with people and with God.
Yeah.
That messes up marriages. That messes up friendships. Like, even something personal, man, like dealing with worrying, worrying about finances. Like, it bothers my wife. Like, when I'm all frantic and panicky about where bill money is going to come from. So I struggle with that, too, and I have to get back to staying focused, having vision for my family, and moving forward, man. So that's huge. That's huge.
Yeah, and you know, anxiety could very well be a huge, a huge symptom of worry as well.
Yeah.
And a lot of people, they struggle with that.
Yeah.
Just the very action of, you know, wilding out, and because worry, you're just thinking.
Yeah.
You have no control over the future.
Yeah.
You have no control of the outcome or the results of any situation.
Sure.
But when you read this, it's like, one, be everything in prayer and supplication and thanksgiving. You just talk to God.
Yeah.
Just talk to God. Yeah. There's so many times, bro, like in my life where I'm afraid and I'm worrying about this and I'm worrying about that, and I find myself just crying my eyes out, bro.
Yeah.
Like, literally, just I'm not afraid to say this, like, just crying my eyes out and just talking to God, like, this is what I'm scared of, this is what I'm worried of, I don't know how I'm gonna do this, I don't know how I'm gonna do that, I have anxiety right now, I can see I have anxiety because I'm like wilding out right now and I'm crying, but even I think some people think they're afraid to just talk to God about what's really going on in their hearts.
Yeah.
This is what that means.
Yeah.
It doesn't mean that you have to, you know, like prostrate yourself like perfectly and throw a robe on and you're like praying like, like, God, I have anxiety. I need help.
No, you
are a broken human being.
And it's not saying to ignore it.
Exactly.
It's not saying that it's not real. Because a lot of people think that we think it's not real because, oh, God handles everything. God is in control of everything.
Mm-hmm.
That's how a lot of people view Christians, that we don't struggle with anything.
Mm-hmm.
But it's obvious. If it's in the Bible, people back then were struggling with
it.
Enough to be written about and looked back on 2,000
years
later. So that's huge, man. I understand, like, clinical anxiety and things like that. There are mental things that go along with it. For those kind of people, but a lot of people who struggle with it, bro, they can get through it by just acknowledging that it's there, saying, "I don't know, God, I don't know."
I don't
pray like just sit there like, "Heavenly Father, we come before you today in the name." Nah, that's not how I pray. I just talk to him like, "God, look, it's what I'm going through."
Yeah,
you know, I mean, I don't know what to do. Just put somebody in my path or put it on my heart or whatever I'm supposed to do. Just how do I get through this?
Yeah.
And I seek his face and I seek the answers.
Yeah. I want to encourage you guys, you know, like, just, you know, when you have these, you know, episodes of anxiety and you're worrying or you're afraid of the future and you don't, really don't know what's going to happen next, just really take this, what the Bible says, and just talk to God about everything.
Yeah.
And supplication, like, tell God what you're worried about.
Yeah.
The Bible says, cast all your cares upon him because he cares for you.
Yeah.
Like, understand that, one, that God cares about what you're worried about, and God knows what you're worried about, but at the same time, just talk to him about it.
Sure.
Tell him your needs, tell him what's going on in your heart, tell him what you're anxious about, but also be thankful for everything that he has given you, and be thankful for, you know, that God is going to lead you, and that he is absolutely not just going to leave you and hang you out to dry. And the result of that, let your requests be made known to God, and the peace of God, which surpasses all understanding, will guard your heart and your minds through Christ. That it means that God will give you the ability to understand that you don't need to understand everything. And like you said, it's not like a Christian that's like, oh, you know, I'm just not going to worry about my life. Like, no, there is a supernatural peace that God gives you that guards your heart and your mind to understand that your life is literally in His hands.
True.
And I'm not just saying that as like some nice little soundbite. Like, you have to really, really understand how to apply that to your life.
You have to believe it. That's the hardest part about
exactly.
it.
Exactly.
You got to believe that that's true.
Exactly. Some people know this stuff.
Yeah.
But they don't believe it.
Exactly. There's pastors that know this stuff.
Yeah.
They don't believe it.
that absolutely don't. You know, and that, I'm glad that Carl brought that up, guys. I want you to ask yourself right now, do I not only know all this stuff? Like, dude, I know that verse, Drew. I know what you're saying. But I want you to start to ask yourself these questions. Do I honestly believe this?
Yeah.
Like, for me.
Yeah.
And start to apply it to your life.
And I had a friend of mine recently I was talking to, because I was struggling with disbelief, unbelief recently. And she showed me a scripture in the Bible where it says, Lord, help me with my unbelief.
Mm.
And that's what I've been praying every day.
Amen.
Since then, man. Like, that's the hardest part. You can say whatever you want in a song. You can get up and preach whatever you want in front of people.
Yeah.
But you gotta wholeheartedly believe what you're saying so that the things that are in the Word and that are written can actually come to pass in your own life.
Yeah.
Being in unbelief is a scary thing.
Yeah.
Being in unbelief, especially when you're looked at as a role model, kind of, and people are like, you shouldn't go through this.
Yeah, but we do.
We do. We do.
We have to.
Yeah.
We have to.
In order to help people.
In order to help people and relate and understand, and it's growth.
Yeah.
It's growth. So let's hit on depression then, because this is something that I have been wanting to talk about since the moment I texted you about this episode, bro. So I'm gonna let you go first. So how has God assisted you but also grown you through this weakness of depression in your life?
So it's still a work in progress.
Mm-hmm.
Every single day. There's points in my life where I'm like, I want to be alone because no one understands what I'm going through.
Yeah.
And I'll go to the car, drive, hit the block, and just like cry. And I'm just like, I question my life. What am I supposed to be doing? Am I doing what I'm supposed to be doing?
Mm-hmm.
And if I'm not, is it worth it for me to even be here anymore? Suicidal thoughts was huge for me in the past.
Mm-hmm.
So it was moments where, like, it's like you can bring yourself to the point where you question it so much that it becomes reality. And that's when you see people who actually go through with it.
Mm.
They question it until they're on the rooftop.
Yeah.
And it's like, can't question it anymore here. I'm here right now. So I still find myself sometimes in that dark place.
Yeah.
God is working on me every day with that. And just giving me a lot of scriptures to deal with. Most of my depression comes through fear, bro.
Mm.
Fear of the unknown. Fear if I'm doing the right thing.
Yeah.
Struggles with like sins you want to stop doing, and that you can't break for some reason. And then when you can't break them, and you're in a leadership role, it's like, bro, I'm not worthy.
Yeah.
I'm not even worthy to. I'm not worthy to talk to these people, man. So battling with your own mind will cause that depression.
Yeah.
Not having anybody to talk to about it, it'll lead to that as well.
Yep.
Being afraid to talk to the people you do have to talk to about it, that'll lead to it as well. Not having friends around you and anybody that is going through the same thing, that'll lead to it as well, man. It's a lonely place. It's a lonely place to be in. And like I said, mine isn't clinical or anything. It's just doubt.
Yeah.
Doubt in myself. I don't ever feel like I measure up.
Yeah.
I feel this big. in this whole world, man. So that vulnerability that I, you know, I, sometimes it's hard to even talk about it.
Yeah, right.
And then you can't explain it.
Mm-hmm.
That's another scary thing. Yeah. When you get to the point where someone's like, what's wrong? Why have you been MIA? Like, why haven't you hit me up? It's like, I don't really know, yeah, bro. I can't explain it. I'm dealing with something. Well, what are you dealing with? Let's talk. Bro, I don't know. Like,
yeah. I know, bro.
Yeah.
I know.
So, I don't know, man. What's some stuff you've gone through?
Bro, like, this is something that I struggle with since I was as far back as I could remember as a little kid.
Yeah.
Like, elementary, middle school, and high school, and I think it began to increase when my parents divorced when I was 16 years old. But it was just something that was always there, and I didn't even know why. Like, teachers would walk up to me, or, you know, people would walk up to me and be like, why don't you smile? Like, why are you so sad all the time? And like you said, I don't even know. And, you know, it was something that, you know, did drive me, and I'm not going to share my whole testimony, but it did drive me into, you know, indulging into more sin, just obsessed with myself, obsessed with my life, you know, who am I going to be? What am I worth? Why am I here?
Yeah.
It's just like me. And I get so sick of me.
Yeah.
And I think that's what makes me so depressed,
to
be honest. But as a young kid, it just got so bad, bro. You know, high school and wanting to kill myself and wanting to just, you know, just, it sounds so like obsessive and it sounds so narcissistic to say that I'm so depressed and I just want people to know, you know, how I feel. So I'm just going to make a name for myself by killing myself.
Yeah.
And I don't say that. I really understand that. I've been there, you That's know, true. And I know if there's someone listening, this could be you.
Yeah.
And in that moment, I have no hope. I have no way out. I don't think anybody loves me. And I'm just really obsessed with me. So when I became a Christian, bro, everything changed. I finally understood how much God loved me.
Yeah.
I finally understood, like, my worth, not only in this world, but in eternity.
Yeah.
I'm His son. I'm loved. I have worth. But even, like, a year and a half into my Christianity, bro, it was still there.
Yeah.
And I was going to Bible college, and, you know, if you're watching this, you know, if you're that teacher, sorry, but I'm going to say this. I had, you know, like, even a Bible college professor tell me, if you don't have the joy of the Lord, if you're just, like, depressed and you're struggling with depression and you're sad, you know, you're probably, I would really question if you're a Christian. Bro, in Bible college.
Bro.
And I'm sitting there, and I'm like, I would question if I was saved. Yeah. Like, am I even a Christian?
Yeah.
Like, God, why am I struggling with it? Like, it was got even worse when I was saved already.
Yeah.
But the reason why I'm sharing this is because God did something through this. So in Bible college, you know, I'm getting fed, and I'm learning, and I'm growing. But this depression was, it was
right
there.
Back here.
It was right. It's like a knife. An invisible knife, when you're just sitting up at night, it's just in your chest, and you're just like, why?
Yeah.
You know, and to be honest, as I grew through that, you know, hearing stuff like that, and reading the word and understanding weakness, and I had to understand, I had to come to this place, and you may not agree with me if you're like a pastor or whatever, I don't care, this is how God helped me.
Yeah.
I had to come to this place, bro, where I literally told God, I remember sitting up late at night, bro, I was addicted to sleeping pills as a Christian.
Yeah.
And I was addicted just trying to get rid of this depression. I'm like praying, God, this isn't going away. And then I remember I was just up late one night, bro, and I just was praying, and I was like, you know what, God, I love you more than this weakness.
Yeah.
And I'm willing to follow you because I love you.
Yeah.
Even if I suffer with this for the rest of my life.
Yeah.
I'm not going to give up. I'm not going to throw in the towel. I might suffer with this pain for the rest of my life, but I know that you've called me and that you love me, and my emotions don't dictate who I am, but your Bible does. And at that, in those moments in my life, I begin to wake up every day and just read the Word. And I would read Psalms like Psalm 42. The Bible says, as the deer pants for the water brook, so pants my soul for you, O God. My soul thirsts for God, for the living God. When shall I come and appear before God? My tears have been my food day and night. It's depression, dude. Yeah. While they continually say to me, where is your God? When I remember these things, I pour out my soul within me. For I used to go with the multitude. I went with them to the house of God, with the voice of joy and praise, with a multitude that kept a pilgrim feast. Why are you cast down, O my soul? And why are you disquieted within me? Wow. Hope in God, for I shall yet praise him for the help of his countenance. Wow. You know, I would read things like that, bro, like just broken, just crying my eyes out. Like, God, where are you? I don't know what's going on. But I would read verse 5, hope in God, for I shall yet praise him. Like, dude, he like, this man, if you read Psalm 42 in its context, these are like the worship leaders, the sons of Korah.
Yeah.
People who worship God that are writing depressive things like this. And I believe the Spirit of God led me and taught me, like, Drew, you have to continue.
You
continue to follow me and worship me, and it's not gonna be like this forever.
Yeah.
Like, you will be healed either in this life or the next. Yeah. But it's not a reason for me to just throw in the towel and stop following God. And through that, bro, like, I'm being completely honest right now. Like, through that, I truly believe I learned what it means when Paul says, you know, in my weakness, I am made strong through infirmities and sicknesses and, you know, downfalls and crazy things that happen, because the Spirit of God rests upon you.
Yeah.
His strength is made perfect in my weakness. And if I'm completely honest right now, I'm not 100% healed of depression. I do know that God has taught me how to allow him to strengthen me through this weakness. Because now when God, you know, on days where you know, God gives me joy and I'm serving him, even though I have pain in my heart and I hate myself and I'm obsessed with me, gotta deny yourself. Stop thinking about yourself. Start thinking about him. Mm-hmm. On those amazing days, bro, I know that it's not me.
Yeah. That's true.
You know, and I want you to be encouraged too, bro. Like, this is how God, and I don't want to use the word cope, because God doesn't help me cope with anything. He helps me to have victory and to heal and to be strengthened through this weakness of depression. But even today, dude, like, I went to Subway and just crazy, you know, that invisible knife that just gets stuck into your heart, and you're like, God, like, man, you know, like, and you start thinking about everything, but I have to come back here tonight and serve Jesus,
that's
bro.
True.
You know what I mean?
That's true.
If I listen to my depressions and, you know, you're not this, you're not that, you should just not go, that I wouldn't even be talking to you right now if I would listen to them.
Yeah, I wouldn't be either. I wouldn't make any more music. That's another thing too. I've considered quitting music a bunch of times because of this. And like I said, the weirdest thing is that you can't explain it. That's the weirdest part about it. When you get to the point where how the verse was saying, people will question, where's your God? You start to question yourself.
Yeah.
Where's my God? Why would you allow me to feel like this?
Yeah.
And that's the scary moment too.
Yeah.
Why do you allow me to go through this? Even Jesus, when he was praying in the garden, he questioned, why is he going through what he was going through?
Mm-hmm.
And I think it's a healthy question.
Mm-hmm.
I think that's what brings strength to your faith. I think that's what allows you to be able to share with other people how you've gotten through it, and that they're not alone. Like, us having this conversation right now, just to know, like, I'm not alone.
Yes.
And I'm sure somebody watching is like, I'm glad I'm not alone.
Yeah.
And really, anybody watching this, if you have any, if you want to talk to me about anything, me or Drew, just leave a message. Like, I'd be more than happy to just talk to you.
Yeah.
Not to preach you to death, to talk to you.
Yeah.
You know?
Yeah.
That's what it takes. Sometimes people need an ear, bro.
Mm-hmm.
I felt like I didn't have an ear for so long. I'm here for you guys. Drew's here for you guys, man. God is there for you.
The biggest part about it, you guys, is that God himself is okay, Jesus, he has the ability to heal like that.
Yeah.
Okay? But he also heals over time through his word.
Yeah.
Some of these things, they take time for us to mature through. Like for me, like for my depression, I really do see how God utilized it in my life.
Yeah.
So I matured through it.
Yeah.
And I'm still maturing through it.
Yeah.
So because now, like, what? And we're going to end right here. I'm going to read it again in 2 Corinthians chapter 12 and beginning in verse 8 concerning this thing. Or verse 7, and lest I should be exalted above measure by the abundance of the revelations, this is the Apostle Paul, a thorn in the flesh was given to me, a messenger of Satan to buffet me.
Yeah.
Lest I should be exalted above measure concerning this thing, I pleaded with the Lord 3 times that it might depart from me. And he said to me, my grace is sufficient for you, for my strength is made perfect in weakness.
Mm-hmm.
Therefore, most gladly, I will rather boast in my infirmities that the power of Christ may rest upon me. Therefore, I take pleasure in infirmities.
Yeah.
It's not politically correct.
Not at all.
In reproaches, in needs, in persecutions, in distresses, for Christ's sake. For when I am weak, then I am strong. You know, when it comes to depression, you guys, it's a very serious thing, but there's healing in Jesus. But there's also the opportunity to take this weakness, and God will absolutely lead you and guide you and teach you and mature you and use your weaknesses for his glory and for his kingdom.
Yeah.
It doesn't happen overnight. Like, for me and Carl, like, dude, we're still works in progress, dude. Like, I'm still learning. I'm still having to face this stuff. But I have to face it, and I have to stop thinking about myself and start thinking about him.
True.
You know, depression's a very serious thing, but God himself, he's willing to help you and to pick you up every single day. You're not alone.
He can
use this weakness to make you strong, but that's a process.
Definitely.
It's a process. All right, you guys. Well, our time is up. I got to let Carl get back to the wifey. So if you guys want to connect with him, make sure to connect with Carl Fontaine on Facebook, on Instagram, and all of his social media outlets. Make sure to check him out on Spotify, and you're on Apple Music, on all that, right?
Yeah.
The whole thing. He's on all that, Google Play, all
everything.
That. Everything. Just look for Carl Fontaine, dude. There's like not that many dudes named Carl Fontaine. You know, that's why you can find him so easily.
Yeah. I'm blessed, and if they put me on the stage, they just scared I'ma kill. We bring the king to the world, dog. I don't even stress.